Hello, everybody. Welcome. Let me just set a few things here and we'll get rolling. I see people joining us, so I'm just going to wait a minute and let people trickle in. And then I'll share my screen with you and we'll get going. Okay, welcome. I think we have a lot of people here and I'm sure we'll still have some people continue to join us, but after being a college professor for over 20 years, believe it or not, I am wise enough to know that we start class on time and we end class on time. So to be able to do that, we have to get going. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you for joining me for our webinar on ADHD and anxiety causes and action steps. So what causes them and what to do about it? We're going to cover it quickly in the next half hour. You will see that you have the ability to ask me a question whenever you would like. You can put it, your question, into the question and answer box. And I will periodically, not that much, not that often throughout our time, look to see if there's any questions, but towards the end, I will look through the questions and answer as many of them as possible in the question and answer time at the end of our webinar time together. So I'll get everybody's questions answered, and if I can't get to all of them, many times I'll make video recordings of questions and send the answers out to you after tomorrow, after our time together, so as not to keep people hanging on too long. Being respectful of time. Okay, so the first thing that I want to be able to dive into so that you can understand what causes ADHD and anxiety is to cover two main aspects of brain functioning. So if you know about me or if you've read about me, you will know that my husband and I, my partner in crime, have a practice called Lee Brain and Spine in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. I will tell all of you who are on this webinar with me today that I provide this as a service for my own community, but I work with a network of doctors across the country. So this is actually a national webinar that's being provided all over the country for many different neurofeedback expert offices. So I'm really glad to have people here from across the country. But to be able to frame what we're thinking about in terms of what causes ADHD and anxiety, knowing that I'm a brain performance doctor, I think about brain functioning and how it plays out in what I call behaviors of the mind and body. Of course, you hopefully had a sense that what causes ADHD and anxiety is the brain. And I'm going to show you that today. So we're going to start with brain areas. Then we're going to talk about brain speeds very, very quickly. It's a little bit of neurophysiology, and then I'm going to share with you the causes of ADHD and anxiety. It's basically the polar opposite. And then I'm going to share with you tips and techniques that you can use today to start helping to combat the brain patterns at the root of ADHD and anxiety. Okay, so what are we looking at? On the screen, we are looking at an international system for thinking about and describing the brain. So you might have heard of hemispheres of the brain before. This is a different way of looking at it. It's called the 10-20 system, and it basically organizes brain areas into those circles that you see on this head. Each one of those circles has been identified by neuroscientists to cause or to control different skills and abilities that a person has. So for example, this area up in the front, which is labeled FP1 and actually F3 also, clearly this picture is simplified, it is the area that is implicated in attention. So it's working memory and attention. This is the guy that's involved in true ADD. The area in the middle is executive function and planning and organization. Over here, FP2 and F4, those areas are judgment and impulse control. Across the middle of the brain is the sensory motor cortex, which is responsible for sensory perception and motor movements. So if someone suffers with sensory processing disorder, many times we'll see an irregular brain pattern across that middle area of the brain. These areas on the side by the ears are responsible for auditory processing. They're actually areas that are strongly implicated for emotional regulation also. And you'll see that on the bubbles here, and clearly it's simplified, but the bubbles give you a sense of what the areas control. In the back, we have cognitive processing, verbal, mathematical, visual processing in the back. The left side is the language area of the brain. You get the sense of what I'm talking about. So the takeaway from this slide is brains have areas, and the areas control the skills and abilities that the person is able to do or to engage in. So we're going to talk about irregular brain patterns. When someone has an irregular brain pattern, depending upon the area that is affected, different symptoms will fall out. And I will get there in just a few minutes. We're going to move on from brain areas to brain speeds. Now I'm trying to take a very complex concept and put it into one slide that's fun and easy to engage with and to think about. But basically, our brain has five primary speeds that it's supposed to be able to shift in and out of. And you can see them here, with these heads. Delta is extra slow speed, and you can see this little guy is asleep. Delta is the mode that kicks in when you're actually asleep. So it's very slow, 2 hertz I estimated at, very slow brain speed that keeps you asleep. Next is theta. It is slow brain speed. It's when you're deeply relaxed or you're groggy or you're falling asleep. So it's still slow, but it's a little bit faster. Alpha is medium speed. So it's when you're calm and relaxed, but fully awake. And you can see that guy looks happy and fully awake. Beta is fast speed. So at the lower frequencies of beta, you feel alert and focused. And I always talk about these middle medium speed alpha and this low beta speed as calm focus. When beta gets a little bit faster in higher frequencies near 25 hertz or 30, when the brain's going really, really, really fast, that creates agitation, feelings of anxiety, overdrive, where you can't stop yourself from going. So beta's broken into beta and high beta. So brains have speeds, and our brains can actually get stuck in a speed. Our brains are supposed to be able to naturally shift gears between these speeds across our day and across our life, and that's called circadian rhythms. When someone struggles with ADHD or anxiety, their brain is stuck in a speed, and I'm going to show you how. Okay, so how do we know if a person's brain is stuck in a speed? This is a picture that I borrowed from a Harvard University article, and if you have any interest in reading it, you can Google it at Harvard Science in the News, ADHD and Neurofeedback. It's really cool. It has a bunch more infographics like you're looking at right here that display a very complex concept in one picture. And what we use in neurofeedback practices and in my office, Lee Brain and Spine, we use EEG. We actually use something called qEEG that takes this a bit further that I'm going to show you in just a minute. But what EEG does is we put a cap on a person's head. It's completely non-invasive. It doesn't do a thing to you. And we're able to see how the brain is using speed. That's what frequency is, where it says it down below that picture of the brain waves, they're actually called brain waves. We can measure speed in every area of the brain. And this is compared to fMRI that only gleans information about areas. So you can see EEG actually gives more information than functional MRI, and it's completely non-invasive. So when we put the cap on a person and all they have to do is sit there, typically it only takes between 8 and 12 minutes, and we're able to get all the information about how a person's brain is performing. And then what it gives us is called a brain map. And this is an example of a peak performance brain map that in this case, and there's different brain mapping systems, but in this case, green is good. And when the brain is all green, it means all areas are performing optimally. So you have a calm, focused mind, a calm, focused body, and you're able to perform all the skills and abilities that the brain needs to in an optimal fashion. So of course, that's the goal for everyone that I'm working with. I want everybody to have as green of a map as possible. But at the bottom, you can see those are standard deviations. So when we see yellow to orange to red, that means that the brain is using much too much of a speed. When we see the blues, light to dark, it means the brain is using much too little of a speed. And I'm going to tell you more about that in just a minute. But so this is what a typical brain map would look like that's using an optimal pattern. Then what we want to be able to look for after a brain map is performed on someone, we want to see what their brain is doing in all of the speeds and compared to the norm. So this is a brain map of the ADHD pattern. So if you remember, a theta is too much slow speed. It is what is shifting you into sleep. Beta is that perfect calm focus speed. So in this brain map, theta is being used much too much, way too much slowing, and beta is being used too little. So I always use an analogy. I use a lot of analogies. I'm sure they're probably slightly annoying, but I think they help people understand. So I use an analogy that if you want to drive around town, you have to drive your car at 45 miles per hour. That gets you around town in perfect timing without crashing. If a person actually has an ADHD brain pattern, what they are doing is, let's say they're driving at 45 miles per hour, but their foot is completely on the brake. Theta is braking of brain speed. So now it means their foot is all the way down on the brake and the gas is not being pushed enough. Their gas is at 35 miles per hour. So what that necessitates in terms of the person is that oftentimes they need to self-stimulate their nervous system and their brain so that they can stay alert and engaged because they're using too much braking and not enough gassing of brain speeds. So many times that becomes hyperactive physical behaviors that a person has. And if they don't have a hyperactive component physically, many times they have a hyperactive component mentally. And I'm going to tell you about that in just a second. Or they just have a lack of ability to focus. And those people, I think, are the most dangerous, unfortunately. And it seems that girls have inattentive type more so than boys, where they just get lost in the shuffle. They don't create any problems. They don't have any behavioral issues. So they'll sit at their desk and not learn anything and not absorb any information. But because they're not a pain, they don't get the attention that they need until they're really, really struggling. But in that case, the brain's not offsetting this slowing, it's just slow and the person's having difficulty focusing. Okay, so this is the ADHD brain pattern. I hope everybody's with me. I'm just gonna check in here and see what we have going. Okay, no questions yet, which is great because we can hold until the end anyways. Okay, so then now moving on to an anxiety brain functioning pattern. And this looks a little bit differently, but the idea is the same. In this case, all the way to the right is high beta, and then the next column over is beta. So clearly, this person is using much too much fast and extra fast speed. So what does that mean for them in terms of symptoms and in terms of physiology? If we go back to our analogy of driving around town at 45 miles per hour, now this person's brake is not on at all. You can see their delta's looking fine. It's green. Theta's green, and those are the two columns all the way to the left. The fast speed, the gas, we want it on 45 miles per hour. This person's gas is on 75 miles per hour. So if anxiety is actually being portrayed outwardly, this is a person who buzzes around, who can't stop themselves from go, go, going. They actually suffer with being completely stressed out. They may have anxiety disorder in a more classical sense, meaning that they feel anxious and different situations make them anxious. What's going on internally is the brain is going so fast. It's using tons of extra fast speed. What that creates is rumination, which means that person can't stop thinking. Many times it tends to be negative thinking, or this pattern creates addictions because impulsive and compulsive behaviors. And I keep doing this because there's an adage of a hamster on a wheel, and this area in the middle is implicated, called the anterior cingulate gyrus. And when people struggle with an anxiety pattern and this area is involved, it's like a hamster on a wheel. So a person will get a thought, and that's how addictions are born, where people need to do something to chill that hamster out and to bring his speed down. And that's why people drink alcohol, use drugs, are addicted to gambling or porn or spending, shopping. All those things soothe the nervous system and give neurotransmitter release in the short run to make the brain feel a little bit better and calmer, because it slows it down just a little bit. But still underneath it, that brain is cranking fast and going 75 miles per hour. What happens if a person isn't showing any outward signs? They're absorbing all that heat. I call it a brain on fire, because usually it's red and orange and yellow in that high beta, and it's very, very fast. So it means that that person's system, their nervous system, has to absorb all this heat. It's literally like a fire on the inside. And if it's not purged, then it's being absorbed. And that person can suffer from kind of, a lot of people, they use, I use air quotes all the time, bipolar types of difficulties, where they're on and then their brain is so exhausted from all of this heat that they're burnt out or they feel depressed. And then once they recover from that, their brain is back on, because underneath it all, it's still going fast in there. So this is literally what causes an anxiety brain pattern. And this is the neurological root of anxiety. So I need to be really clear about that, is that anxiety is a neurological disorder, as is ADHD. They have behavioral symptoms that feel psychological, but they are psychological, but they stem from a neurological pattern. And if you're interested in seeing any of the science behind that, on my website at Leigh Brain and Spine, there's a tab under the About tab that says the science, and I have a few of the articles, recent scientific articles there, about ADHD and about anxiety and about a whole bunch of other things, because I am just the messenger. Everything I'm telling you is based on science. So that's why so many times, if the neurological pattern isn't addressed underneath it, it can be difficult to make headway in both of these challenges. Okay, so moving right along, I would be remiss if I didn't briefly tell you how neurofeedback works, because I'm completely passionate about it. I promise you, there's only one slide, and there's two slides, one on how it works and one on the mechanism behind it. So this is so that you understand that it's a really powerful tool to be able to change these underlying neurological patterns. But after I tell you how neurofeedback works, I'm going to give you tips and strategies that you can start using immediately that will help you to be able to address these patterns. And then at the end, I am going to do just a little intro on screen time, because next month we're talking about screen time. I'm just going to show you the brain pattern that screen time can create and give you a tip there. So we're not spending tons of time on neurofeedback, but I really want you to know how it works, because it's one of the most powerful things too. You know, here we're talking about causes of ADHD and anxiety and what to do about it. And especially for people who have tried many, many things to address these problems and they still have them, neurofeedback many times is the thing that can move them forward. And especially in combination with any other services, most times when people come in and see us for, especially for anxiety, but many times for ADHD too, we work very strongly with mental health professionals. Okay, anyways, enough of that. How neurofeedback works. You can see in this picture, and that's actually my son Declan, who's now 15. He looks so cherub-like there. But you can see that he's sitting in the chair, and he's connected to the neurofeedback transmitter, which is behind him, by four sensors. The transmitter is connected to the computer, which is connected to the secondary screen. So when people come in for a neurofeedback session, we've seen their brain map. We know exactly what their brain is doing. And I will tell you that many times, and this is what I alluded to earlier, many times when people have an ADHD brain pattern, so I told you, their foot is on the brake and their gas is only at 35, not 45. Many times the brain self-compensates, and it will, instead of creating hyperactive behaviors to self-stimulate the brain, it's mental hyperactive behaviors that self-stimulates this slow braking pattern. So guess what that means? Many times ADHD and anxiety occur together. So that's comorbid. They occur together because the braking of the brain makes it so that the brain kicks it into overdrive and pushes the foot on the gas. So now the brain's going 75, and you can't see my hands, they're down here, 75, and their foot is on the brake. We've got gassing and braking, and that creates a lot of behaviors in people who have both patterns. So once we see the brain map, we know if someone has the ADHD pattern, we know if they have the anxiety pattern, we know if they have both, we know if they have more patterns. Any pattern a person has would be evident. So we work with people with head injury, with misophonia, sensory processing, dyslexia, a lot of brain-based challenges. But when the person's connected to the neurofeedback system, what happens is they're watching a movie on the secondary screen. And I know that sounds like magic. People say all the time, I don't get it. How can I watch a movie and my brain performance improves? I'll tell you how. It's operant conditioning. It's scientific. And if you don't know, I have a YouTube channel. I tell my six little darlings, my husband Cosmos, whom I work with, he and I have six kids. We have three boys and three girls. And yes, I like to brag to them that I'm a YouTuber. And they don't exactly think that's cool, but I think it's cool. So I'm trying to create more and more videos for people, short ones, so that if they want to know how this works, there is a short video there. And operant conditioning is when a person sits in front of the screen. What happens is the screen plays bright and the audio plays louder when that person's brain is making more of perfect medium to low fast processing speed. So when a person is in calm focus, we've got more brightness and more auditory feedback. It's visual and auditory feedback based upon the production of perfect processing speed. If the person's brain goes out of the zone and now they're making too much slow or too much fast processing speed, the screen goes dim and the audio goes low. And it's our systems are state of the art. They're the highest grade systems that will give very, very specific feedback. So what happens is over time, that person's brain learns the learning modality to make more perfect processing speed and less of the speed that is causing the challenges for the person. And there's lots and lots of science, again on the science tab, that shows that these changes become permanent. And that's the next slide. I just wanted to be able to tell you how these changes actually stick. So it's called a feedback loop. If a person has what I consider to be a negative, and again, it's in air quotes because most of those terms I don't really like, but I'm going to use it anyways, a negative brain pattern. And it's negative because it's getting them behaviors that get them negative outcomes. There's a scientific law called Hebb's Law that shows that the more you use that brain pattern, the more it is hardwiring itself in scientifically. So you use the ADHD pattern and it's going to get worse unless you do something to make it better. So then what happens is when we use neurofeedback, we're breaking that negative feedback loop and we're creating a more positive brain pattern. In the ideal world, we're creating the optimal brain pattern. And then the person gets better outcomes, better behaviors, which gets them better outcomes. And it's funny because we try to have our patients celebrate the small wins, and people love to tell us the ridiculous things that they've celebrated. Someone was celebrating a 69 that their daughter got on a test 2 weeks ago. And the reason that's important is because she's always failed her test. It's the first test that she has passed. And so, yeah, it's not 100, but it's passing. And it has not happened before. So we celebrate that small win. What happens? Hebb's Law again says that now that better outcome is going to hardwire in that new, better brain pattern. So in the programs that we offer, the way that we provide services gives the brain enough time to shift from a negative pattern to a better, optimal pattern, and then stabilize itself and hardwire itself in. And when the positive feedback loop is created, it will become self-rewarding over time. And that is how it works, and it's all scientific, and I think it's one of the most awesome mechanisms in the world, which is why I wanted to share it with you. But for the sake of time, we're going to move on to tips to improve focus and anxiety. So these are things that you can do right away. And this slide is not rocket science, but I'd be remiss if I didn't mention it, because it really can be very powerful. So next month, we're talking about electronic screen syndrome in this webinar. Moderate screen time is okay, but you have to let your children or yourselves take equal break time on a one-to-one ratio. So if you use your electronics for an hour, you need to take a break for an hour. And next month, we're going to talk about all the damaging effects of excessive screen time, but we'll just leave it at that, moderation. And we're going to look at a peak slide in just a minute. Sleep. So anybody who knows me knows that I sleep like it's my job. I follow the exact same sleep schedule. And if I can't, of course, I'll violate it for special occasions. But generally speaking, it doesn't matter what I'm in the middle of around my home. I have an alarm basically set to go to sleep early. And actually, it's close to my bedtime. And I will consistently go to bed at that time. And I wake up very early, but I consistently wake up at that time too. Be consistent, be routine, and get enough. That is important. Nutrition, you need to eat clean, whole foods. Recognize anytime you're putting anything junky into your system, you're bogging that brain pattern down, and that's proven also. Okay, I already talked about the need to purge that anxiety brain pattern. I have a little trick that I like to call the purge and reboot. Now, the most important thing that I can communicate on this slide is for you to think about, and you can think about the people in your life or yourself, if you have a behavior, especially a behavior you don't like, that behavior serves a need of your nervous system. So, and actually I use my own behaviors as red flags. I have, you know, going to bed early and consistently is part of what I call my brain health program. And when I start to do certain things, I know something's breaking down, and that something is generally I've gotten too busy, and then I take things off my plate. So for example, if I start to excessively check my phone and I care about my emails, which generally I don't, something's off. I'm running hotter than I normally would. So that behavior, the checking my phone, that behavior is serving my nervous system that's running hot. It's feeding that pattern. So then I have to purge the need for it and reboot my system. So when it comes to children, for example, if they have an ADHD brain, they really need to self-stimulate that slow-running brain. But, so like, for example, one technique that many occupational therapists use is having kids bounce on a trampoline first thing in the morning to kind of stimulate that brain before they go off to school and have to sit there. But that's the purge part. The reboot part is then having your child be able to sit and quietly read for longer and longer time frames, or trying to have the homework routine become faster and more efficient. So those are just a couple examples. Okay, but I'm going to give you one tip for improving focus and one for improving anxiety, and then we're going to wrap this part up and do a real quick screen time. So this tip to improve focus is amazing, and you need to try to do this on the daily, as my children say, to challenge your brains in two ways. First, find your meditation, in the air quotes again. And if you meditate in actuality, that is beautiful, because there's tons of science that shows that puts your brain into calm focus. But if you haven't meditated before and it is difficult for you, because it probably will be, then I want you to find the thing that you do that makes your brain feel calm and focused. Everybody has one. You might not engage in it, which is the reason that's the tip. Start doing that thing. So for example, I love to read. So I purposefully cut out time in my day to just chill and read. And I also go for runs every day. So both of those things really put my brain in a good spot. My husband loves to golf. He golfs at least 2 times a week. Then, secondly, challenge yourself. So those are things that put your brain into calm focus, but you want to really challenge your brain too. So for example, with your children, if reading's difficult, and actually for some adults we work with, they haven't read a book in years and they want to, start with one page. If it's difficult for you to get in bed and read a book, start with one page. Build yourself up to 2 pages. Build yourself up to 3 pages, and so on. That will improve your focus, calm focus. Okay, tips to improve anxiety, and I use this one, unless my brain health program's gone to pot, I use this one just about every day also, is you need to come out of your head. If you have a high beta pattern, I joke with people once I have a relationship or rapport with them in the office that when they say certain things, I'll say, that's a really high beta thing to say. And a gentleman was saying more is more, and he was going on about how more is more. I'm like, more is not more. That's a high beta thing. Balanced life is where it's at. So when you're in your head a lot, that is because of high beta. So you need to come out of your head and out of your thoughts. And it's being present. But when, if you, someone tells you to be present, you might not know how to do that. I'm going to tell you how to do that. Take in your surroundings. Listen to the birds. Go for a walk. It's best to do this outside. You can go for a 5-minute walk. But if you can't, a lot of times I'll just do it at my desk. I look around. I can look at the lights on the walls. I listen to the traffic outside. I come out of my head and I put myself in my current environment and I absorb it. I am in the present. And you need to do it one time an hour. Because if you have a high beta pattern and you have anxiety, the more you're in your head and you're using high beta, it is getting higher and higher and higher across your day. One time an hour, if you take just a minute break and you come out of this high beta pattern, you're basically letting it go back down and you're saving yourself from these extremes. So you should start doing that right away if you suffer from anxiety. We consider all these tips to be brain workouts. If you'd like more information, I have a personal website, which is drtrishleigh.com. At that website, I can say whatever I want and not worry about my license. So there's a lot of brain tips there. And I have blog posts on techniques and tips, and I provide brain tips once a week to people who want them under the Harness Your Brain page. So I encourage you to sign up for those if you're interested. And I've been trying to use social media more. I answer neurofeedback questions and answers on my YouTube channel. So if you'd like to email me any questions, I'll make you a video and I'll put it there for you. And on Instagram and Facebook, and I also put them on YouTube in my blog post, I use the hashtag control your brain or it will control you. Because if you struggle with anxiety or ADHD, your brain is probably controlling you. What I am telling you today is that you can regain that control and keep that control across your lifetime. And I would love to help you in any way that I can. And that's a way for me to be able to do so if it feels good to you. Okay, so now just to, actually I'm gonna see if there's any questions here and then I'll give the screen time tips because we're running out of time. So let me just look and see. That is my son. That's exactly it. Someone recognized my son in that picture, which is so funny. And isn't he so cute? Doesn't he look so much younger? Now they're all teenagers around here, so you know how that is. He's a man child now. Okay, so let me just wrap up with some screen time tips. And we're a little over, but since we have no questions, there's only two slides. And this is the main slide that I need to communicate this to you. Also, when it comes to screens, there are recent studies that show that this is how screens are affecting our lives. And I know everybody out there knows that screens are affecting our lives, but this is how it's actually happening. Increases in anxiety, increases in OCD. So when I talk about that need, and I keep pointing to my phone, it's on the desk. When I talk about the need to check that phone, that's a compulsion. So if you feel the need to check your email, to check Instagram, to just text people for no reason, that is a form of OCD, and there's a lot more of that because of screens. ADHD was up 800% between 1980 and 2007 when they did a longitudinal study. 800%. Don't get me wrong, there's other factors, but screens have to do with that, and next month I'm going to tell you how. Sensory overload. People are now becoming accustomed to constant input, and that is not good for us. I've already told you about addictions and how the brain pattern for anxiety is one that's at risk for addictions. So now put excessive screen time on top of that, and guess what happens? We've got all those addictions happening worse than ever. Social problems. And I'm working on this with my crew because they have their heads buried in their phones. And what that means is they're not making eye contact. They're not chit-chatting. They don't know how to initiate conversations, not my children in particular. This is what the science shows, that young people don't know how to respond. Social skills are just plummeting because people are in their phones now instead of in the world. So, I mean, that's another tip of being present. Stay present while you're walking around town, while you're at restaurants. Don't bury your head in the phone. Get out in the world and be IRL, as the kids say, in real life. Depression's up and sleep problems. One more tip for anxiety and for ADHD. Turn your screens off 2 hours before bedtime, or at least 1 hour. So in my home, I start dimming the lights as soon as it gets dark, so our bodies and brains can start making more melatonin, so it's easier for us to shift into sleep. Screens resonate at 60 hertz. They are wiring and tiring your brain. So this is the last slide I have for you in the sneak peek, and then there's a couple more questions that came in. Brains are becoming wired and tired because of screen time effects. This is what it looks like. And now you know how to read brain maps to a certain extent. We have high beta, all red on the right, delta, all red on the left. Wired on the right, too much extra fast speed. Exhausted and tired on the left, too much extra slow speed. So here's a challenge for you. Stay up for 2 days and then be late for work. Your brain will be tired and you will be wired. See what kind of mood you're in, see how productive you are, see how nice you are to people. That's what screens are starting to do to us. So if you know someone who uses screens excessively and they come off and they are a monster, now you know why. One question is, does screen time include cell phones? Yes, it does. Screen time is, science has proven, and I have a slide for next month in here, screen time is proven to be worse on phones and computers than on TV. So, which is interesting because nobody's watching TV anymore. But I'll give you a tip that's in next month's slides. There is a downloadable program called Flux, F.Lux, that you can download on your computer screen. So it changes the blue light to red. So it filters that so it's less harmful. And I have my blue light glasses that are in some of my videos, and I'm not wearing it for the webinar, but these are blue light glasses. They're not prescription. They're just filtering the light from my screen so it's less harmful on my brain. These are $20 on Amazon. So if you, those are two things that you can do to really help. And now most cell phones have the adjustment, so you can have it so that your phone is automatically switching more towards red light or dimming as the day goes on. Let me see. There's a question about stimulant use and neurofeedback. And I actually have a slide, not in this presentation, but actually a lot of studies have been done, but I use a slide that shows a study that shows that in conjunction, stimulants and neurofeedback really helped children and adults to be able to perform better. And the takeaway from the slide when I show it to people is that in the study, when just medication was used, brain patterns are proven to never change and kids got, their behaviors got better. But when neurofeedback was included, the brain patterns actually changed and kids' behaviors got even better than the other group with just medication. And then after the washout period, it stayed better. So basically, yep, you can do both of them together. Most times it's a goal for people to be able to wean either down on the medications or off them entirely. And I will tell you, we have a scientific process, and any of these doctors across the country that I'm talking to you about, anybody here could go to a neurofeedback expert, and we use a very scientific process to be able to measure when it would be a good time to wean off medications. It's all informed by the neurofeedback brain map and trend graphs that show us how the brain is performing. And last question for the night, there's always a question about insurance. There are insurance codes for neurofeedback, but you need to check with your insurance provider. And if you're calling for my office at Lee Brain and Spine, if you call Whitney, who's my assistant at our desk, she can provide for you the decision guide that we have to help people understand what's going on with insurance. So we do not file insurance for people, but we give you a super bill, and it's hit or miss if people are able to get reimbursement. But there are codes for neurofeedback, and it's different across the country in different states. So if you're here from a different state, then you want to check with the provider who has sponsored this webinar for you. So check into that, because the question, of course, the answer is maybe. Okay, thank you so much for spending your time with me tonight. I know how precious time is, but I hope that you have found this information informative, and go start using those tips immediately. And if you feel stuck, you literally are, your brain pattern's literally stuck. And the way to get unstuck is to have a brain map and to find out what's going on in there. That's the first step. And then the next two steps in any neurofeedback expert's process is to use neurofeedback to unstick that brain pattern and to give you the tools to keep it unstuck so that you can feel and perform better for the rest of your life. Okay, thanks again for spending your time with me, and I hope you have a beautiful evening. Thanks.